Father, thank you again for the privilege to worship, you in this campus site. Thank you for all that have come today. Thank you for what is going on up to this point in the service. Thank you for the opportunity to not only share the Word of God, but to get into the Word of God and allow it to speak to each of us. So today we would ask that you'd open our eyes that we might see, our ears that we might hear, and our hearts that we might receive. You've promised us that when we gather in your name, whether it be a few or a lot, that you're going to be with us. Father, may we know that when you make a promise, your promise is real. May we make sure. May we make sure before we leave the house today that we sense the presence of God, that we feel the touch of God. Let me know that you're here. And we know that you love us because a long time ago, you sent your Son down from heaven to take on an old earthly body. He did that. To live with us, he did that. To preach to us, he did that. To heal, he did that. To do miracles, he did that. And then one day, he rode into Jerusalem to give himself up as that sacrificial lamb. He did that. And when we thought all was over, when his disciples felt like that the man that they believed was from God was dead, on that third day he rose again. Thank you, Father. Thank you for the assurance of the gospel that we believe, the gospel that we preach, the gospel that we sing about is a real thing. And we've come today to worship you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Turn in your Bibles, if you will, to 1 Corinthians. And Keith, I think I come off and left everything in my office except my... I brought everything with me except my clicker. So if you go back and get my clicker while you're going, I think what kind of got me off of my regular schedule, I brought my iPad in. I was going to show you how smart I was, but now I can't even get the new King James Version up. So being an old country boy like I am, I felt that that's God telling me, no, you stick with the King James. So we're going to be using that day. Been a great weekend here at Hillsford Church. Friday night and yesterday we had our marriage conference, had a young man in that shared the gospel, did the teaching, and was a great, great time. We were told how to love, we were told how to straighten up our marriages, we were told how to be a good husband, we were told how to be a good wife, we were told how to be a good mother, we were told how to be a good father, and we were also told how to be a good child of God. Great weekend. And this week, incidentally, is the week of love. On Tuesday, I'm sure, men, you already know about that. Already got your gifts. It is Valentine's Day. Not Valentine's Day. It is. What is it, Tuesday? Valentine's Day, yeah. You can tell I'm off today. So, it's all about love. And that's where we're going in our message today. We're going to be dealing with love. And we've titled our message, A Love That Lasts. A Love That Lasts. 1 Corinthians, the 13th chapter. And we're going to be looking at the entire chapter. Thank you, Keith. Be looking at the entire chapter for our thoughts today. Now, the Apostle Paul is speaking to a young church in Corinth. He's speaking to a church that was next to his heart. He's speaking to a church that he had helped to establish, and now he had got some word from them that they were kind of getting some things confused, and a church can very much get things confused. Whenever our main thing ceases to be obeying God and the very word of God and teaching and preaching and singing about God, when our main thing ceases to be that, we have lost our direction. That was what was happening with the church at Corinth. They had gifts in the church. They had prophecies. They had teachers. They had preachers. They had the gifts of tongues. And so the people kind of decided that I want the best gift that God has to offer. And I think we all do. But you know what? All of us have a gift from God. And that gift may be different and probably is different from any other gift. And we're the only one that can exercise that gift to please God. And when we please God, we're going to please some people around us. Doesn't mean we're going to satisfy everybody. We aren't going to be able to do that. Even Jesus couldn't do that. But we do have a gift. And when we start coveting somebody else's gift, then we're wrong. That's exactly what the young church was doing. And Paul wrote to them. He wrote two letters to them. But on this particular letter, he was trying to get them back on track. And I think possibly he's talking to us today too, making sure that we stay on track. That we do what God has called us to do. That we be who God has created us to be. When Paul closed the In the 12th chapter, he was talking about the gifts, the prophecy, the tongues, and those kind of things. And when he closed that chapter out, he says in the 13th verse of the 12th chapter, but covet earnestly the best gifts. And yet I'm going to show you a better way. And that's what he's talking about in the 13th chapter. Let's read those verses, if you will, and then we'll get into our outline just a little bit. Paul said, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, and have not, and the King James says charity, that is translated love, and that's what I'll be using the rest of the reading of this particular passage. Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, and have not love, I am become a sounding brass or a tingling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy, and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have faith so that I could remove mountains and have not love, I am nothing. And though I bestow, though I give all of my goods, everything that I have to feed the poor, and though I even give my body to be burned and have not love, it profiteth me nothing. I think we'll hold up there just for a second. And I remind us, including myself, that whatever your gift, my gift, may be from God, if we do not season it and bathe it in love, no one profits from your gift or from my gift. If we don't season it with love, no one profited from that. So Paul was saying, in referring back to chapter 12, he said, you may have the gift of prophecy, but if you aren't bathing it in love and doing it the way God that would have you to do, then nobody is benefiting from it. And my question to myself, as well as you, is somebody around us benefiting from our being where we are and being who we are? Is there someone benefiting? And let me tell you something. If we are doing it God's way, if we are doing it God's way, someone is benefiting by your presence and by my presence. Someone is benefiting. No matter how small we might think that gift might be, but when it's God's gift to us, God had a purpose for giving us that gift. He knew who we would be in contact with. We knew who we would better influence around us. He knew all of that. So be who you are. That is what Paul is telling the church at Corinth. Be who you are, but no matter what you do or what somebody else does, the greatest gift of all is love. Agape love, the is the word that we translated love from, agape. That means a sacrificial love. That is the love that Jesus Christ had. When he left heaven and came down, and when he died for us. Love is a giving. We have degraded that word in our time that it's almost a bad word to bring up because we think all kinds of thoughts. But God's love, agape love, is one that not only benefits me and you, but it benefits other people as well. So now Paul has already shared in these first three verses with what gifts are not. Now he goes on to tell us what gifts are. I use this passage in every wedding that I do. Verse 4. Paul says, love suffereth long and is kind. Love doesn't envy. Love doesn't vaunt itself, King James. It means it doesn't brag on itself or set itself up on a pedestal or higher than someone else. It is not puffed up. Love does not behave itself unseemingly. Love does not seek its own way. It does not want its way all the time. Husbands and wives, that's something that we need to think about in the home. Are we just wanting our way and our thing? Are we realizing that there are two people and with children, more people in there, and other people needs to be safe and to feel comfortable in that home as well? And then picking up in verse 6. Love doesn't rejoice about iniquity. Love doesn't enjoy doing wrong or seeing wrongs or being a part of wrongs. Love doesn't enjoy that. But love rejoices whenever truth wins out. Whenever truth wins out. I have a motto whenever I'm counseling people, whether post-married, pre-married, or even just counseling somebody that's going through a problem. Seek first to understand before you try to be understood. That was brought out again in our seminar Saturday. Don't always try to make sure somebody understands your feelings before you understand their feelings. Real love is, let me hear what you have to say before I know what I need to say, to show you that you are somebody, to show you that you are important to me, that you are important in my life. And then, verse 7, love beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, and endureth all things. Sometimes I have a little trouble wrapping my mind around that because I don't think as God thinks, I think as Melvin thinks. This is not meaning that we will just tolerate everything. It doesn't mean that we will accept any belief. It doesn't mean that at all. It's simply the word itself translated from the Greek word means to cover. And breaking that down, it simply means to when we look at other people, we don't look at the bad that may be in them or judge them. We look at the good that may be in them. We let them be who they are and allow the Holy Spirit to do the working in straightening out their spiritual life. We set good examples around them. Doesn't mean that I'll just bear anything is acceptable. The word itself means to cover up. To cover up. It doesn't mean to cover it up in a wrong way. It means to not identify that person because of the things that they do. Identify them as a real person. As a person that God loves, that Jesus Christ died for. That's what that verse means. And then we'll hop on down to verse 9. Excuse me. For now I know in part, and we prophesy in part. That simply means I don't see the whole picture. I don't see the whole picture. Verse 10. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is part shall be done away with. Will we ever see that which is perfect? Yes, we will. Yes, we will. Not in this imperfect body, not in this imperfect world, but one day we will see as perfect as God sees, as Jesus sees. And then we will know as we are known. So we live in an imperfect world. Don't you expect me to be perfect because I can't. I don't expect you to be perfect because you can't. But I know that when Jesus Christ went to the cross at Calvary, he went for imperfect people. He went for imperfect people. So don't expect that we will ever become perfect on this world. Now that doesn't mean anything goes. It doesn't mean that at all. It does mean that we're going to live by the book. We're going to try to obey the word of God. But we know that we aren't perfect, and we know other people aren't perfect that's around us. But verse 10, but when that which is perfect is come, and it will, then that which is in part shall be done away with. When I was a child, I spake as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. Let me just remind you a little bit. You or I don't care where we are in life. We don't think like we did when we was an infant. We don't think like that. We don't cry, at least I hope we don't, when we're hungry. We know a little bit more how to be who we are right now. That's what this is talking about. When we become that adult, then we put away those childish things. I used to love to play with cars in the dirt. We would make roads and we'd just run that car all over those roads. But if I was to do that now, Mama would call the wagon to get rid of me. Why? Was that fun then? It was fun. But it's not fun anymore. Why? I've grown. I've grown at least up to here. That's what it is talking about. It is talking about as we grow. As we grow, we change the things that we like to do. We change the things that we like to do best. And I hope that as we grow and we change those things, one of the things that we like best is being a child of God. Being a child of God. And I don't have to tell you, but I will. How do we get to be a child of God? We accept the fact that Jesus Christ left heaven, came to earth, lived with us, died for us, rose again, in order that we might become the children of God when we believe what he does. When we believe that John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. When we believe that, and I hope that that's a part of our life. I hope that's a part of every person in the house's life today. And when we think of love, we think of that sacrificial love. And we love others without judging them. And we can expect them to love us without judging us too. To love us without judging us too. And then the 12th verse, now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. But then we will know as I am known. And now abideth faith, hope, love, these three. But the greatest of these is love. The greatest gift, the greatest example that you and I can be in our world, in our home, in our school, in our workplace, is be a person that loves and cares for others, and that is agape love. That is not some of this trashy love that we have all over our world today. That is an agape love. That is a godly love. That is the best gift that we can have. We may never stand on a pulpit and preach. We may never stand on a pulpit and sing. We may never even give a testimony verbally, but we will live our lives to where people will know who we are. That's what the church, what the world needs today. I don't think I have to tell you that we live in a permissive society, that we live in a sinful world. I don't think I have to tell you that. But what the world needs now is to see examples of people that are biblical Christians, that are biblical Christians, that don't toot their own horns, that is not puffed up. That's what the world needs. Sure, we need missionaries, but that's a missionary within itself. That's a missionary within itself. Let's very quickly, and we'll do it very quickly, look at our outline, if you will. You can fill in some blanks. I subtitled my message, and I didn't want to put this on the sign outside because it needs some explanation. Love does not hold hostages. Love does not hold hostages. What do I mean by that? I mean that in your home, you can be who you are. You don't have to walk on eggs. You don't have to cater to somebody else's every desire. You can be who you are. And when we have a home that we have to walk on eggs to keep somebody from hollering or shouting at us or getting angry at us, then we are, in a sense, being held hostages. And if we're holding somebody else like that, then they're being held hostage in your own home. That's what I mean by that subtitle. Love does not hold hostages. Now let's fill in a few blanks. Number one, what Paul is telling us here in these first three verses is what love is not. Love is not bragging. Love is not wanting the top seat at the table or in the congregation or whatever. Love is loving people and taking what God gives us. In basketball, I always tell people, take what the other team gives you. And that's exactly what we need to do in our world. We need to take what God gives us. We need to take what God gives us. We need to be who we are. We need to run those game plans. And God has set up the game plan for Christian people, folks. Don't ever forget that. When I chase the word love in the New Testament, well over half, and I think probably three-fourths of those scriptures that are talking about love, it's talking about loving others. Now, it doesn't talk a whole lot about loving ourselves in a selfish way, and I think we have to love ourselves. I think we have to realize that this is what God gave me, and God had a reason for giving me this, and I am going to be who God created me to be. You don't have to put up a front for anyone. For anyone. Not even God. He knows who we are. So love is not, the three verses, I don't need to go over those again. It is not prophesying. It is not moving mountains. It is not faith. It is not all of that. It is not knowing all mysteries. And when we have that gift, or if we had that gift and we didn't season it in love, then it would be a very selfish thing. We would be doing everything to profit ourselves. Secondly, what love is. Is what Paul is telling us in verses 4 through 7. And I'm just going to read those again, just in case you didn't hear it. I think it's good for us to read them again. verses 4 through 7. Love suffereth long. Love is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not put itself upon a pedestal. Love is not puffed up. Love does not behave itself unseemingly. Love seeketh not its own. It is not easily provoked. Thinketh no evil. Rejoices not in iniquity. Rejoices in the truth. Beareth all things. Believeth all things. Teacheth all things. And love, in verse 8, never fails. When we love with a godly love, it never fails. It never fails. How do I know that? The Bible tells me so. The Bible tells me so. And then thirdly, what makes lasting love last? What makes lasting love last? Number one, Paul is reminding his people here that agape love, godly love, the love that he's talking about for the church to have back at Corinth, for the church to have at Hillsford Baptist Church, he's talking about a love that has absolute permanency. Honest love will always be honest love. True love will always be true love. Trashy love will be trashy love until we change it. Until we change it to be the way that God has it to be. But God's love, the type of love that God is talking about, that Paul is talking about here to the church, has absolute permanency. It never fails. All other love, all other gifts will fail one day. They won't need the gifts of prophecy, won't need the gifts of faith, won't need the gifts of healing. One day we'll be perfect, but perfection, listen to me, perfection cannot survive without love. Perfection, biblical perfection, cannot survive without love. So absolute permanency. And then Paul, the second thing that he speaks out about here is love has absolute completeness. When we love with agape love, it's complete love. It is not an if love. If you do so and so, I'll love you. If you look a certain way, I'll love you. If you act a certain way, I'll love you. Not what this is saying. I love you. That's what Jesus said when he went to the cross. He is saying, I love you. I don't care who you are. I don't care what you're doing. I don't care where you are, what color you are, what denomination you are. I love you and I'm dying for you. You know, sometimes we forget that, don't we? We kind of forget that. That Jesus died for us. It's not about what we do. It's all about what he did. It's all about what he did. And then Paul's love that he's talking about has absolute supremacy. When everything else is not needed, when we become perfect, as the scripture said here, in that perfect life, when we no longer look through a glass darkly, we still need love. We still need love. Songs of Solomon has a verse in it that I love, 8:7. You may want to mark it in your Bible if you mark in your Bibles. Many waters cannot quench love. Neither can floods drown it. Nothing can distract. Nothing can take away from this love that Paul is talking about. The one unconquerable thing in the world that we live in is love. Godly love. What's in your heart? What's in your heart? Father, thank you again for our time together to just be reminded of a story that we've heard over and over again. What love is, what love is not. The importance of love. Thank you for reminding us As we approach this week that we kind of call Love Week, Valentine's Week, Valentine's Day, Tuesday, may we just kind of reignite our love for each other. May we love like you challenged us to love. Father, I hope every person in the house has already accepted Jesus Christ. But just in case someone has not, I pray that the Holy Spirit might already be tapping on that door and saying, hey, today's the day. God loves you. His Valentine for you is that Jesus Christ hung on a cross in the first century for 21st century beings. Your will be done in this time. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.